On the morning of Monday, September the 10th, 1923, a mysterious woman in black was escorted to the dock of London's Central Criminal Court. Her name was the Princess Fahmy Bey. 2 months before, at the Savoy Hotel, she had shot dead her husband, an Egyptian prince, with three bullets in cold blood. But 6 years before, she'd had a secret affair with another prince, the future Edward VIII. Back then, the Princess Fahmy Bey had been plain Marguerite, or Maggie, Meller, a high-class courtesan in World War I Paris. As Maggie Meller went on trial for her life, this reckless episode from Edward's past threatened to expose the heir to the British and imperial throne to disgrace.
The French girl who is going to be tried for murder is the fancy woman who was the Prince of Wales's keep in Paris during the war. And they were terribly afraid that he might be dragged in.
Behind the trial lies a long-buried story of royal infatuation and royal scandal. Maggie Meller was Edward's first mistress. Their relationship was the first step in transforming him from a sexual innocent to the sophisticated darling of interwar society, and ultimately the prince who would abandon his crown for another overwhelming passion. But it was an affair that exploded in a toxic cocktail of sex, blackmail, murder, and a secret cache of vanished letters. And new evidence points to it ending in a shameful establishment cover-up to protect the reputation of the future king.
It is fortunate that he is off to Canada, and his name is to be kept out.
Andrew Rose is a criminal barrister turned historical detective. He's an aficionado of notorious criminal trials and wrote a book about the sensational case in 1923 of Princess Fahmy.
It was a story of a beautiful woman who shot dead her super-rich Egyptian playboy husband, followed by a sensational trial in which all sorts of allegations were made. I thought it was a cracking good story.
But it would turn out to be an even better story when an entirely new angle came from an unexpected reader in France. He was Princess Fahmy's grandson, Raoul Laurent, and he realized that, understandably, Andrew Rose only knew part of the picture.
In this family, all the children have been born out of wedlock or from adulterous affairs. So it's rather difficult to find traces of anyone. He wasn't even aware of my existence.
Raoul Laurent decided to write to Andrew Rose.
What he was saying was, as far as his grandmother was concerned, I had forgotten the most important of her clients, who were British.
He wasn't aware of Edward.
The chain of events begins in 1912. Edward spent that summer in France and stayed with the family who would eventually bring him and Maggie together. Europe's royal families were basking in what seemed a golden era of peace and pleasure. And nowhere was more peaceful and pleasant than the magnificent Chateau Breteuil, 30 miles outside Paris. There, Edward made some new friends.
Edward really had the same life as the two young Breteuils. He was 17, one François was 18, Jacques was 16, and that's why he felt really at home in this chateau.
The Breteuils' unique family album records Edward's summer of innocence with them 2 years before World War would engulf Europe. For the young heir to the throne, entrapped in a world of officialdom and formality, that innocence extended to sex, too.
He was sexually completely inexperienced. He had scarcely met a woman outside a rather stuffy court circle.
He met rather elderly ladies, the Duchess of Luynes nearby, the Princess Murat, And maybe he met some of the young girls of the family. We had first cousins who were girls, but I never heard of any little love story.
I think he wistfully wondered from afar what it would be like, but it seemed to be a different world.
30 miles from the Chateau Breteuil, that different world was flourishing. The demi-monde of 1912 Paris. Behind the city's imposing facades, high society, particularly its men, was at play. One destination was the glamorous, ornately decorated brothels, or maison close, where the courtesans entertained.
These were magnificent places because they needed to attract the aristocracy of Europe. So they turned these maison close into a sort of almost Disney wonderland type of place. You'd see Baroque, you'd see gilding, you'd see something oriental. It was a fabulous, exotic atmosphere. Sex was there to be enjoyed in all its multifarious variations.
As the 18-year-old Edward relaxed in the rural innocence of the Chateau Breteuil, an alluring young courtesan was making her name in this Paris demi-monde. She could dance, sing, play the piano, and cut a striking figure on horseback. Her name was Marguerite Meller, known to all as Maggie.
When she was 20, 22 years old, she was already extremely socially adept. It was also her beauty and her freshness.
Attraction wasn't merely sexual. You would want to take her out for the evening. You want to be seen with her. You want to go to the opera, to the theatre, to the smart restaurants.
Toute la noblesse et la bourgeoisie qui était
all the nobility and upper middle classes used to go, plus the ladies of the demi-monde, to entertain the guests.
Les invités.
The catalyst that brought the Parisian demi-monde and Edward together was war. Edward spent World War I doing staff jobs away from the front, and to his frustration, was never allowed to fight. He was also still a sexual ingenue, but in 1916, when he was 22, Edward's time came.
His two equerries eventually decided that this belated virginity should be put an end to, and so they set him up with a charming French prostitute called Paulette, gave him an excellent dinner, got him slightly drunk, and popped him into bed, and it went wonderfully.
But Paulette was only on loan from another officer and had to be handed back.
Oh, to set eyes on one of the darlings again. How one does miss them. And I don't think of anything but women now, though what's for use?
Edward needed a woman of his own, and the place where the real fun lay was Paris. On the morning of the 23rd of April 1917, travelling under his pseudonym, the Earl of Chester, Edward drove to the capital in his new Rolls-Royce coupe and installed himself and his valet in the Hotel Maurice in the Rue de Rivoli. He then went to lunch in the Ambassadeur restaurant at the nearby Hotel Crillon, to meet his old friend François de Breteuil, with whom he'd shared that innocent summer 5 years before. With François was a rather special lady.
It's François who introduced the prince to Marguerite. Introductions had to be done. Marguerite was a courtesan, but a high-class courtesan, and the formalities had to be observed. And then after lunch, they probably went for a drive in the Bois de Boulogne. And then, most likely, to her flat, not so very far away, because ladies like Marguerite used to leave afternoons free for liaison, preferably the late afternoon. They're often known as the dames à 5 heures, the ladies at 5 o'clock.
Edward was blown off his feet. 5 days later, he wrote in his diary,
"How perfectly bloody this endless war is. Of course, those 3 days' bliss in Paris have made it all the more bloody."
Edward was 23, Maggie 27. In experience, she was light years ahead. For Edward, she was a bolt from the blue that would hurtle him into ecstasy and the threat of blackmail and scandal. On April the 23rd, 1917, at the Hotel Crillon in Paris, Edward, Prince of Wales, laid eyes for the first time on Marguerite Meller, dazzling, high-class courtesan. For barrister-turned-historian Andrew Rose, the next step in piecing together Maggie's story was to visit her grandson, Raoul, and find out more about the woman Edward met that day.
I met Raoul Laurent face-to-face in Paris, and it was a most interesting discussion. He confirmed the relationship between his grandmother and the prince, and he had no illusions about his grandmother. He knew what she was, what her profession was, what she did. After we'd met, Raoul sent over some marvellous photographs and also a memoir.
In this rare memoir, written years later, Maggie gave a somewhat embellished view of her early life.
Je suis né à Paris le 12 décembre 1892.
I was born in Paris on the 12th of December 1892 under an excellent horoscope.
I was all amused to discover that she said that she'd been born in 1892. Her birth certificate shows she was born in 1890.
Yep, it's 1890. But that's normal. We all try to make ourselves younger.
Excellent horoscope.
Born under an excellent horoscope to a father who was a solicitor's clerk called Alibert.
Non.
No. Her father was not a solicitor's clerk. He was employed in a small firm of taxi carriages. She tried to put a gloss on her social origins, shall we say.
What is indisputable fact is that around the age of 15, Maggie became pregnant by an unknown man and gave birth to her only child, a daughter, Raymonde, Raoul Laurent's mother.
She, let us say, disposed of her, in inverted commas. And my mother was taken into care on a farm close to Moulins, in the centre of France. During the first 7 years of my mother's life, when she was in Moulins, the relationship between her and my grandmother was non-existent. She never saw her.
Maggie bore the shame of being an unmarried mother. She was cast out onto the streets at the age of 16 and, it seems, ended up working as a prostitute. But she was soon noticed by a Madame Denard, who ran a high-class brothel in Paris and turned Maggie into a desirable and educated courtesan, suitable for her most distinguished clients. Men became Maggie's one way to rise in the world.
You need to find a man who's going to provide you with all the luxuries in life. That's the reassurance you need, that if the relationship ends, you've got some tangible property that you can sell. You need reassurance that you're not going to be left penniless and just have to go back to some sort of low-life brothel. These are high-class courtesans we're talking about.
One man in particular changed Maggie's life.
He was called André Meller and was the son of a wine merchant from Bordeaux. He had even sold wine to the Pope. He had a stable of race horses. He was very successful, and he charmed me with a wink.
She became a kept woman. He bought her a flat, or got her a flat, set her up there.
And so André Meller married me, and thus I became Madame Meller, step one.
This was another gloss. In fact, Meller, a Catholic, was already married and unable to get his marriage annulled.
She took his name, a nom de guerre, let's say, Maggie Meller. She really wanted to have the name of someone who to the bourgeoisie meant something important.
Eventually the couple parted company in 1913. But by this time, Marguerite had a number of strings to her bow, or possibly bows to her string. Rich men, bankers, industrialists, members of the aristocracy. She was developing a really good stud book.
She never had one lover at a time. She had three, four, or five. and say she'd get herself offered the same present, and she'd take it back to the jeweller or the leather merchant or whatever, and she would get reimbursed a quarter or a third of the value. And in that way, she made a bit of money. But she always kept one of the items she'd been given, but not the four or five that had been bought for her.
As Maggie rose in the world, one distinguished friend she'd made was François de Breteuil. And when in April 1917, François introduced her to his friend Edward, Prince of Wales, she'd finally graduated from the Paris street to the very top of the social tree.
She was sitting at this table at the Crillon, the Les Ambassadeurs restaurant, opposite the heir to the greatest empire the world had ever seen.
In Maggie's memoir, Edward is given only the most discreet of mentions. Indeed, she never even refers to him by name, only as the Prince.
The Prince held out his hand. I leaned towards him and was unable to stop my body radiating joy. The Prince asked me, "Would you come for a trip in my car?" I blushed, then clapped my hands to show how happy I was.
His 3 days of bliss with Maggie, as Edward described them in his diary, though he also never fully named her, transformed his life. She offered excitement like no other before.
Goodness, doesn't she look strong and dominating and commanding? Of course, this wonderful, erotic riding whip just behind her shoulder. And one has to assume, knowing Edward as one does from history, that because he loved the sort of verbal whiplash, that the physical whiplash wasn't far from his liking as well. I think this is absolutely the most revealing picture of all of them. She's saying, "I am full of Eastern promise." She's saying, "I can promise you a good time."
Maggie ignited Edward's sex drive.
The Prince really was in full spate. He was in many ways a bit like a dog that's been put to a bitch for the first time. He was off.
Andrew Rose has discovered a previously unpublished letter written by Edward to his friend, Cecil Boyd Rochefort, in which he displayed his new enthusiasm.
"A little of the English tart goes a long way, and they aren't a patch on the French ones, are they?" And his thoughts clearly were going back to Marguerite, because at the end of the letter he wrote, "I shall have a shot for Paris leave later on. My woman writes me the most wonderful letters!" !
Edward was also writing letters to Maggie.
"He wrote to me all the time. He called me Marguerite, my baby, and included in his letters all kind of photographs from camp at the table with the French in uniform, in shirt sleeves, etc."
Edward could not resist writing letters. He clearly wrote a lot of letters to Maggie, and they were, to judge by his other letters, they would have been rambling, somewhat incoherent, extremely affectionate. He was a man of appalling indiscretion. He could not keep a secret. He was simply unsafe.
Edward was taking risks. He itched to be with Maggie all the time. The amorous couple gave each other gifts, chocolates from him and erotic literature from her.
One evening he was gayer than usual. That was after I had made him read Le Roi Puzzle. He had never enjoyed a book more.
In late 1917, Edward's pleasures were unexpectedly curtailed. He was posted to Italy. But there are still hints in another, previously unpublished letter to Cecil Boyd Rochefort of his ardour for Maggie.
He was obviously yearning to get back to Paris, hardly surprisingly in view of what he wrote. He said, "I got 24 hours in Paris, one undisturbed night, which made up for a little of the leave I missed." As far as Italy was concerned, he wasn't the least bit complimentary about either of the soldiers. "Not certain that these bloody ice creamers are going to fight. Or indeed, I'm afraid, Italian womanhood. They are the ugliest collection of bitches I've ever seen, and I've hardly seen a fuckable one yet. Anyhow, Paris," underlined, "is always on the direct route home." Paris, of course, meant a time with Marguerite.
In 1918, Edward's passion for Maggie cooled. Exactly why remains a mystery. Maggie's discreet memoir said only,
"Peace arrived, and that put an end to everything."
What is known is that in early 1918, Edward embarked on a long and significant affair with Frieda Dudley Ward, the wife of an English MP. It also seems that Edward did not have the guts to tell Maggie he was ending their affair.
Marguerite may have realized that the prince had passed through Paris without seeing her. And if the prince thought that he could simply dump Marguerite and that would be it, he was very much mistaken.
Maggie had a hold over Edward, his letters. From his contact with Raoul Laurent, Andrew Rose was able to glean something of what was in them.
Raoul Laurent's mother, that's Raymond Laurent, Marguerite's daughter, saw the letters. She knew what was in them. And she told her son.
They were letters in which Edward criticized his family. He blamed his family for the way he was raised and that he couldn't lead the life that he wanted. And I know that both my grandmother and Edward had practices that were a little exotic, let's say. He spoke about this in his letters, that's for sure.
Edward was aware that when they separated, that she had got in her hands a potentially explosive collection of letters, which could have done him a great deal of damage if she'd chosen to reveal them.
In November 1918, Edward told his attaché, Joey Lee, that Maggie was threatening trouble.
I got a regular stinker from her this evening. Oh, those bloody letters. I'm afraid she's a £100,000 or nothing type. Though I must say I'm disappointed and didn't think she'd turn nasty. The whole trouble is my letters, and she's not burnt one.
But by the end of 1918, there were signs that the storm from Paris had blown over.
Not another word from Maggie, thank God. So here's hoping.
For the moment, it seemed, Edward had got away with it, but his letters were a time bomb. For the 4.5 years after their relationship ended, Edward, Prince of Wales, and Maggie Meller, his first mistress and Parisian courtesan, went their separate ways. Peace had finally arrived. Edward became the darling of the British Empire, Maggie the darling of a succession of wealthy men. She married one of them, Charles Laurent, heir to a retail fortune. Maggie's daughter, Raymonde, now in her teens, assumed Laurent's surname. As well as respectability, Laurent offered greater riches than ever.
Elle était terriblement ambitieuse.
She was terribly ambitious. She'd always known what she wanted. She chose her lovers very much with money in mind.
Réellement en fonction de l'argent.
Maggie was even rich enough to send Raymond to boarding school in England.
My grandmother was in charge of Raymond, and I think my grandmother was like a mother to Raymond. She had to go with her to the boarding school in England from time to time to visit her, to see how she was there. I think it was a choice of the mother who didn't want that Raymond was too near of her. Raymond was a beautiful girl, and maybe she would have done a shadow on her mother.
Within 6 months, Maggie divorced Laurent. He had served his purpose, but he still settled a handsome lifetime allowance on her and paid the rent of her magnificent apartment in the heart of affluent Paris. From the harshness of her early life, Maggie's unusual combination of talents had brought her glittering success.
She was really a woman who was just like any industrialist or businessman. She had to have real strength of character to be able to do this kind of job, in inverted commas, as a demi-mondaine or companion. And she had to know absolutely everything, about politics, as well as about theater, economics. And she had to combine it all.
As Maggie worked her way through Parisian high society, Edward was touring Britain's far-flung possessions, and by the summer of 1922 was the poster boy of the British Empire. He must have thought his affair with Maggie was far behind him. But then, in July that year at another Paris hotel, Maggie Meller had a second fateful meeting with a second prince. He was a 23-year-old and extremely rich Egyptian called Ali Fahmy.
He wasn't a real prince. His father had built a hospital in Cairo, and Fatekul, the king of Egypt, ennobled him and gave him the title of prince. For my grandmother, it was a success to carry the title princess.
When she'd married Monsieur Laurent, she said she'd kick him out in 6 months, and she did. And she got a handsome settlement out of him. But with Ali, it's a whole different ballgame. Laurent was rich, but Ali was super rich.
Ali proposed marriage. Maggie accepted. She had to convert to Islam to avoid Ali being disinherited for marrying a non-Muslim. In early 1923, Maggie sailed down the Nile in Ali's sumptuous yacht to join Lord Carnarvon's dig at the tomb of Tutankhamun. Maggie and Ali were now arguing. She wanted to be as free as she'd always been. He wanted her to be a submissive wife. Maggie began to construct a litany of complaints against Ali. She wrote to her lawyer in Cairo.
I have to bring to your notice very grave incidents. For the last 3 days, I have been a prisoner on board. I have on my arms the marks of my husband's gentleness. I ask you to send here one or two persons who will confirm this condition, so as to make use of it.
By studying the way in which Marguerite was behaving from the time that she and Ali got married, it's pretty obvious that she was heading for an expensive divorce settlement.
Maggie then claimed that Ali began to terrorize her.
He raised the whip and bound my back and arms in front of all his secretaries with their assassin expressions, his Arabs and his black henchmen brought from abroad, and threw me into my room.
Was Maggie really under threat? Or was she deliberately setting Ali up? Different verdicts have passed down the generations.
I know the story of Maggie from the sister of my grandmother. One day, the prince swore that Maggie would only be killed by his own hand. And from that time on, Maggie had a pistol under her pillow and slept with the pistol.
It was above all a question of money, or not enough jewelry, not enough presents, or not enough... What it adds up to is not enough money.
In July 1923, Ali and Maggie, the Prince and Princess Fahmy, arrived in London for the summer season, staying at the Savoy Hotel. Maggie now had a new allegation against Ali. She summoned the Savoy's house doctor complaining of painful hemorrhoids, which, she claimed, were caused by her husband, who had torn her by unnatural sexual intercourse.
He wanted something that I'd never have imagined. He held me in his strong iron-like arms and forced me savagely, in spite of my cries.
Marguerite claimed that Ali's sexual preference was anal intercourse. Of course, it's something which prostitutes have used from time immemorial because you don't get pregnant by this. And of course, there are some men who like this form of activity.
Maggie asked the Savoy's doctor to provide a certificate attesting to her injuries.
Something of this sort would help enormously in her divorce proceedings if he was regarded as being of a perverted sexuality, as it then have been described.
On the evening of Friday, July the 9th, Ali offered a reconciliation. Maggie rebuffed him, then announced her intention to return to Paris. At 9:10 p.m., Ali sent telegrams to three exclusive Paris jewelers and fashion houses. They simply read, "Nothing to be delivered to my wife on my account during my absence. Fahmy." Ali then went out to a nightclub. Maggie retired to her room. In the small hours of July the 10th, the most violent thunderstorm in years raged over London. At around 2 a.m., Ali returned. How events then unfolded would, 3 months later, be played out in a court in two wholly different scenarios. But there was no doubt about the final outcome.
My grandmother, mad with rage, took a gun and shot him in the head three times.
At 3:25 a.m., Prince Ali Fahmy died. On the night of the shooting, Edward was just a mile or so away at a society dinner in Mayfair. The next day, as the newspapers splashed the sensational news of the Savoy shooting, he must have been filled with dread that Maggie had returned to haunt him. Within 24 hours, his program for September was changed. Instead of a tour of English and Welsh cities, he would make a trip to Canada. It meant Edward would be out of the country during Maggie's trial. The trial began on the 10th of September, 1923. Maggie was charged with murder. If found guilty, she would be hanged. No transcript of the trial was made, but the newspapers gloried in every detail. The trial was a sensation. It also took a most unusual course. We asked one of Britain's top criminal QCs to analyze it. First, the prosecution case.
I would have thought it was a very formidable case indeed. Reasoning being, three shots in the back. There was no suggestion of an accident, nor could there be. This was as strong a case as you could get.
According to the prosecution, after Ali returned at 2 a.m., an eyewitness, the Savoy night porter, John Beattie, heard the couple arguing. Beattie then saw Ali coming out of the suite and looking for his dog. Beattie said Maggie followed him out with a gun.
I have absolutely no reason to doubt the statements of John Beattie, which are absolutely consistent. He made several statements.
A firearms expert stated that the gun was not fully automatic. Each shot must have required a deliberate movement of the finger to the trigger.
This woman would have held a pistol. Thus, she would have had to fire three separate and distinct shots. One, two, three. This was an execution.
The case seemed clear-cut, but then the trial was taken in an extraordinary direction by Maggie's defense counsel, the renowned barrister Edward Marshall Hall. Ignoring the evidence against his client, Marshall Hall embarked instead on a character assassination of Ali Fahmy. He accused Ali of being a ferocious brute with Eastern cunning and vile with a filthy, perverted taste. Hall also attacked a key prosecution witness, Ali Fahmy's secretary, Saeed Anani. Crucially, Anani had testified that Ali and Maggie's arguments almost always stemmed from her bad temper rather than Ali's behavior. To undermine Anani, Hall implied that he'd had a homosexual relationship with Ali, which at the time was not just illegal, but wholly unacceptable to society.
I can't think, in some ways, of a more damaging allegation to be placed before a jury. It was about the worst type of behavior which you could allege in public of a man.
But Marshall Hall was playing a dangerous legal game. Under the rules of evidence at that time, if the defense attacked the character of a prosecution witness, the prosecution could ask the trial judge for permission to interrogate the defendant's own character.
The law would provide an element of tit for tat. You have made accusations against our witnesses. Let us see what your character is.
After the attack on Inani's character, it was at the discretion of the trial judge to decide how far the prosecution could go in probing Maggie's character. The judge, Rigby Swift, ruled that apart from Maggie having had a child and one previous husband, nothing could be mentioned before the time she met Ali Fahmy.
I find it very surprising because his ruling was so limited that he was effectively saying to the prosecution, you can have a little peccadillo as to her character, but what you may not have is what in reality is the truth you cannot place before the jury, that she was a common prostitute at the age of 16, how she graduated up the ranks to become a courtesan, and later the implication by her other conduct that she was frankly a gold digger.
The judge specifically ruled there could be no discussion of Maggie's relationships with other men.
That's very important because one of those other men, of course, was the Prince of Wales.
The judge's decision was the game changer. The jury would never know what Maggie was really like. Unchallenged, she gave a tearful performance as the oppressed woman, forced by her husband into violent and unnatural sex, who finally had to save her own life.
He seized me suddenly and brutally by the throat. His thumb was on my windpipe and his fingers were pressing on my neck. I pushed him away and he crouched to spring at me, saying, I will kill you. I now lifted my arm and without looking fired the trigger. The next moment I saw him on the ground before me. I do not know how many times the pistol went off.
Maggie's version flew in the face of both the forensic evidence and eyewitness accounts. Despite that, it took the jury just 1 hour to find her not guilty.
Matters were arranged with a little divine intervention. It was a pleasantry.
A joke.
I think the whole trial was really a bit of a show trial with an aim to get an acquittal at the end, not to look like a trial in Stalinist Russia or Hitler's Germany where you wanted to get a conviction. Here the authorities wanted to get an acquittal. Last thing they wanted was a conviction and a death sentence and death row and all the rest of it.
Andrew Rose believed that the conduct of the trial and the silence about the Edward connection smelt of some kind of fix. He began to assemble a series of clues. The pattern of a remarkable deal would emerge. Barrister-turned-historian Andrew Rose believed there was something suspicious about the trial that had led to Maggie Mellaire's acquittal of murder. It also seemed her relationship with Edward, Prince of Wales, may have been suppressed. He began to assemble some clues. The starting point was that at the time she killed Ali Fahmy, Maggie still possessed Edward's potentially damaging love letters.
The whole trouble is my letters, and she's not burned one.
As soon as the royal household were aware that Maggie had been arrested, they would immediately want to know what she proposed to do about the letters. It was of paramount importance to find this out.
Rose then discovered that almost as soon as she was taken into custody in Holloway Prison, Maggie had a significant visitor who had a connection to Edward.
It was Major Ernest Bald, a man she'd first known at Deauville in 1913, and who seems to have kept in touch with her ever since. He visited her frequently between the middle of July and the middle of August. Ernest Bald was a close friend of the Duke of Westminster, who was himself, of course, on very friendly terms with the Prince of Wales. What I think Major Bald was doing was acting as a go-between between the royal household and Maggie.
Andrew Rose had also received evidence from Ali Fahmy's great-niece, Dr. Faika Croisier, that there had been activity with Edward's letters after World War I.
I was told, she wrote me, by one of my late uncles, that Maggie surrendered the Duke of Windsor's love letters to the High Commissioner posted in Egypt after the Great War.
After the First World War, a senior British diplomat in Cairo was Archibald Clark Carr, a man close to the royal family. On Tuesday, August the 21st, 1923, 3 weeks before Maggie's trial began, Clark Carr made an unexpected and unexplained journey from Cairo to London.
Clark Carr would have been a natural choice as postman to bring these letters back.
At this very moment, there was another unexplained journey. The day after Clark Carr arrived, Edward interrupted his Scottish holiday at Balmoral to travel to London. He stayed for one day only and returned to Scotland.
Quite why the prince came back, of course, is an open question. But it is a remarkable coincidence that it should have been so shortly after the arrival in London of Archie Clark Carr, the likely vector of these letters.
These clues were circumstantial evidence of some kind of horse trading over the letters. Then Andrew Rose had a breakthrough. While researching at the British Library, Rose came across a letter. It was written the day before Maggie's trial began by Lord Curzon, then British Foreign Secretary, to his wife. Curzon was a man at the epicenter of the British establishment. A man in the know.
It's dated September the 9th, 1923, and it begins, "My darling girl, in London the other day, I heard a piece of news which may amuse you, if you do not know it already. The French girl who shot her so-called Egyptian prince in London and is going to be tried for murder is the fancy woman who was the Prince of Wales's keep, in inverted commas, in Paris during the war, and they were terribly afraid that he might be dragged in. It is fortunate that he is off to Canada and his name is to be kept out." Now, this letter is of enormous significance. It doesn't look like a smoking gun, but that's what it is. It shows that there was an agreement. His name is to be kept out.
The inference from the date of the letter and its phrasing is that Curzon knew of a deal to keep Edward's name specifically out of the trial. And if there was a deal, what was in it for Maggie?
She faced a capital charge. She risked the death penalty. I think the only thing that could be offered to her by the royal household in discussion with the Director of Public Prosecutions, who had already tipped off the judge, was an assurance that her character, her background, would not be brought out. That was of paramount importance, because if the jury had known that she'd been a raunchy sex worker in Paris for years before she met Ali Fahmy, then their verdict might well have been completely different. And it was in this light that the judge repeatedly ruled in the course of the trial that there was to be no mention of her relationships with other men. Her life before that time was absolutely and completely off limits, and the jury would never know anything about that.
The judge's ruling had a dual effect. It meant the jury could not know the truth about Maggie, and also that Edward's name would be kept out. Having examined Andrew Rose's findings, Edward's official biographer believes they raise important issues.
I think Andrew Rose has put up some very interesting information and posed a lot of questions which need answering. It would not surprise me at all to know that certain highly placed people felt it was their duty to take whatever action they could to protect the Prince of Wales in this case and pull some pretty powerful strings to make sure that that happened.
Maggie Meller had got away with killing her husband. Ali Fahmy's family fought to keep her from his money, and it was not until 1937 that a final settlement was reached. She carried the title Princess for life. As she said in her memoir, she was deadlier than the male.
As in Arab stories, all my enemies die one after the other. Why should I fear these ogres, the worst men? Are only ogres.
As for Edward, his taste for dangerous women ended with another affair, one that cost him his throne.
From these photographs, I would say the man who loved that woman is the sort of man who one day will love Mrs. Simpson.
After World War II, both Maggie and Edward found themselves living in the same city, Paris. It's not known whether they ever cast eyes on each other again. Maggie Meller, Princess Fahmy, died in 1971 at the age of 80. Her final apartment in Paris's Place Vendôme was the smartest of the lot. Her grandson discovered that she was still living on handsome settlements from five different lovers. She was the great survivor. But is that a cause for pride?
Fier, non.
Proud, no. But I do take my hat off to her for having been able to get herself out of the situation in which she found herself. Proud, no. Proud of someone who murdered their husband? No. Please. That would appall me.
Là, je me révolte.
If a central theme of a judicial system is let right be done, it's clear that in this case, right was not done. And it amounts to a classic example, in my view, of an interference by the ruling establishment in the judicial system to produce an end that they wanted. They succeeded in this. It was a very cleverly planned endeavor, and it worked. But it wasn't justice.
Next Tuesday night from 9 o'clock, it's a cutting edge film, the story of Britain's biggest ever crash for cash insurance ring. And next tonight, Shameless. I wouldn't put it past them.